All right, today's message, the benefits of adversity. And what I hope to accomplish today is the mindset that you're gonna wake up every day with the focus or with the mindset of going against some adversity, right? Creating your own adversity. So we're gonna talk about the benefits of adversity, and then you're gonna see why I'm encouraging you guys to get you some adversity. All right, how do we define adversity? Okay, I'm gonna give you guys the Webster's definition first. Okay, so adversity, a state or instance of serious or continued difficulty or misfortune. Okay, that's typically how we would define adversity. We look at it as something that causes some sort of complication in our life, has some difficulty, okay? The leadership definition, and this is important, okay? We need to start changing how we view various things that happen in our lives, pretty much starting with perspective, right? Our perspective. So, the leadership definition. Adversity, the establishment of mental fortitude, the construction of a deeply rooted yet impenetrable foundation, the human growth hormone for character building. I want to break this down. So, the establishment of mental fortitude. Can someone quickly on their phone look up the definition of fortitude?
Endurance. Courage in pain or adversity.
Say that one more time.
Courage in pain or adversity.
Courage in pain. Or courage in adversity, right? So, the establishment of mental fortitude. So all that is courage, okay? Does courage mean being without fear?
No.
Anybody else? Does courage mean being without fear?
No.
Courage means recognizing that there is some fear,
yeah,
but having the courage to go forward, right? So, adversity, establishment of mental fortitude, mental courage. Meeting the problem head on, recognizing that there is something in front of you that you should fear by normal standards, right? But if we change our perspective, now we understand that we have to practice having mental fortitude, okay? In addition to that, the construction of a deeply rooted yet impenetrable foundation. What is impenetrable?
Anybody? Nobody can break it down.
No one can break it down, okay? What do we see happen consistently in life from other people? When you set out, you have a goal, what is the first thing that happens when you share your goals with someone, your dreams?
The
first
thing. They knock down.
They knock them down. Right? They knock them down. J. Cole has a line where he says, if they don't know your dreams, then they can't shoot them down. Right? So, deeply rooted. How do you establish having a goal or a dream or a vision that is deeply rooted? How do we establish that?
Build the foundation for it first.
How do we do that though? How do we construct that?
Encounter adversity.
Okay, but let's go a little bit deeper. How do we make sure, because we understand that we're dealing with adversity, right? But how do you ensure that this mental fortitude, right? How do we construct it in a way that becomes deeply rooted?
Scheduling your plan, you start living that way.
Scheduling.
Visualizing.
We talked about what out there? Creating a what? A mental diet.
Yes.
Right? A mental diet.
Right.
This is how we ensure that it's deeply rooted. Okay, so if you're struggling with something, right, and it doesn't necessarily have to be something that you feel like you can't do, but you're just trying to figure something out. That means that everything that you consume on a daily basis should consist of feeding that dream. Right? That's how you ensure that something is deeply rooted. What are you consuming on a regular basis? Most of us consume doubt. We share our vision with a bunch of people that haven't done what we're trying to do. It makes absolutely no sense, but this is what we do consistently. You go to the neighborhood with your friends, they haven't done anything, they're sitting around, same place that they always sit around. They don't think like you, okay? No one has their own business, and you tell them you want to start your own business. What's the first thing they say?
You're crazy.
But if you go to someone who started their own business, what will they tell you? They'll tell you all the pitfalls and things that you need to look out for, but they won't tell you that it's impossible. If they're successful. Now, if they're unsuccessful, they'll tell you it's the worst thing you could possibly think about doing, right? So it's important that we also talk to what type of person? A successful person. Okay? So, we established what mental fortitude is, the construction of a deeply rooted yet impenetrable foundation. You guys have to feed the dream every single day because you're going to encounter adversity every single day. Okay? When you wake up in the morning and you know you're about to go into a strenuous workout, what's the first thing that you need to do? Before that, when you wake up in the morning, you know it's going to be demanding, what do you need to do? You need to fill your body with what?
Healthy food.
Now, you can't eat heavy, right? Because you'll be throwing everything up. Okay, it's the same thing with your vision and your goals. You have to have a healthy diet. This is how you make sure that everything is deeply rooted and impenetrable. A healthy diet is so important. It's vital to the success of whatever dreams and goals you guys have. You guys understand it? Everybody with me? Any questions so far? Okay. All right. So once we ensure that it's deeply rooted, through consistency, it becomes impenetrable. The consistent pursuit of something on a regular basis is what establishes this, okay? Now, the human growth hormone for character building. Not to get all religious on you guys, but D.B. spoke about this earlier. There is a scripture in the Bible that says, count it all joy when you encounter various trials and tribulations, for it brings about patience and understanding, right? To establish perfect character. A quote that I live by is my own quote. I didn't take this from anyone. Talent without character makes you a liability. How do we establish character? By dealing with adversities. All of this stuff is connected, guys. We can't even begin to talk about dreams and visions and goals and all these different things if you guys aren't prepared to handle adversity. Okay? There's something that I need you guys to look at. When we change our perspective from what the world tells us adversity is, okay, and we start to establish the mind of leaders, then we redefine everything, right? Just on how we change it, okay? We change it drastically, right? To the average person, I am POSSIBLE spells what?
Impossible.
Right? Impossible. That's what that spells. But if you separate the IM, add a little apostrophe, I'm possible. It's all perspective. It's all how we choose to look at things. Right? Okay, let's move on. All right, so the next one is, what is adversity directly connected to? Any ideas?
Something that's halting you from living your dreams is being successful.
Okay. Hurdles you gotta hop over. Okay. Deal? JT, you got something?
I like real life situations.
Okay.
Like road closures?
Yeah, what is that adversity directly connected to?
Your goals.
Jarvis? Drawing blank? Okay.
Yeah.
So Dio's the only one that came up with something that was actually positive. So we just went through that whole thing. The leadership, right? But I just want to show you guys how it works, right? So we just went through that whole thing about how to look at adversity.
We still went back to it.
You see how the mind, right? You got to be trained, right? All right. Okay, so now we're going to lock in real quick, okay? So what is adversity directly connected to? First thing. All right. Patience. JT. Patience. you need patience, guys. You need it. Because sometimes things are going to take long. We live in a microwave society. All right? Where even the microwave takes too long. I know you guys have all been at a point where you've eaten something up in the microwave, and you're sitting there like, how long does a minute take? It takes a minute. It's not going to go any faster. A minute takes a minute. But we live in a time where even a minute is too long. Somebody somewhere is trying to figure out how to speed that microwave up because it's taking too long. All right? Patience. Next thing. Growth and confidence. Okay? Growth and confidence. Adversity forces you to grow. To establish patience, right? In a situation where you're an unpatient person, you know the next step is to grow. And when you grow, as a result of that growth, you build confidence. You know how many players commit to, and I'm gonna use a lot of basketball references just because I do basketball training, right? So forgive me. Almost everybody here played more, so it's all right. And if you don't, you know a little bit about it. How many players do you know that put in a week or two and they're already kicking and screaming because they don't see any growth, any difference, any change? They've sucked for the last 5-6 years of playing basketball. They come in, they work out, 2 workouts, 3 workouts, 4 workouts. They have no patience, so they see no growth. That everything's tied in. Have patience. You're going to grow and develop confidence. How do we apply this in our everyday lives? What is something you're impatient with or for?
Overall success.
Hmm?
Overall success.
Okay.
Me.
Okay. Explain.
So, in multiple areas of my life, like, because I'm impatient for success on like basketball, success on like on for business, like I should be doing certain things and taking the slow road to those goals instead of just, like you said, pushing for them in a way that's too fast.
What is success in basketball?
For me,
mm-hmm.
It's might be a little. I mean, maybe it's an NBA that is a success for me.
Okay.
But
now, outside of that, what is success? Okay, there's only 400 slots.
Right.
So outside of that, what is success?
Also, it's being the best player I can be. And that might sound cliche, but truly like...
No, it doesn't sound cliche.
Being, learning as much, as many tools as I can into my game.
You know I'm going to tear you up, right? You know I'm going to tear you up.
Yeah.
Yes, right? Okay, so... the other day, Delano, I asked him to send me a bio, right? We sent me a bio. Wee's bio was probably about 4 lines long, 5 lines long. Delano sent me a bio, and it was 35 to like 40 lines long. So tell me again, how do you define success?
Say that.
Right. So we already know where this is going, okay? His perspective. Sometimes in life, we've accomplished things and we don't even realize it. How do you define success? Do you know how many people would kill for the level of accomplishments that you've had despite the adversity that you've gone through? Did you play AAU basketball?
Yeah.
Did you play AAU
basketball? Yes.
No, you didn't play AAU basketball. Did you go to one of the top high schools in New Jersey to play basketball? Okay, yet you still managed to solidify a Division II scholarship, a full ride, right? Not once, but twice. And we're working on the third time, right? Despite the adversity. Is that not success?
Oh, it is. Yeah.
What was your GPA coming out of high school?
Like 3.0.
Okay, what is your GPA now?
3.6.
Oh, okay. That's not success?
Oh, it is.
All right, so a lot of times in life, we're stressing over things. We're actually hyping up the adversity to be worse than what it is. So a lot of times, right, because you have no or patience. You can't see the, right? And you lack what? Okay. JT, how many times you tried for the basketball team?
A lot of times.
Okay. The last time you tried out, you didn't make it. What was your response to that?
I was broken down.
Okay, and what did you say you were gonna do what?
I was gonna quit.
Oh, right. So, no patience. No growth. No confidence. I need you guys to get this. All right, there's more to, you know, to this list. It keeps going, but I just want you guys to understand, like, those are the first three things. And when you run from adversity, all right, when you turn your back to adversity, you're saying that you don't want to develop patience, you don't want to grow, you don't want to develop confidence. Understand what you're telling the universe now. All right, let's go to the next one. All of these go in order, okay? So when you develop patience, you grow. Now you have confidence. And what does that confidence lead to?
Understanding who you are as a person. Yes.
Right. A couple weeks ago, you came here. You're living in a situation. You weren't happy with the situation. Okay, cool, no problem. But then we have a conversation, and we talk about the circumstances that you're in. And we basically summed up these four things. If you become a little bit more patient with who you live with and why, you'll do what?
Right.
Okay. And then you'll develop a what in yourself. And now you understand why you're living. Okay? Again, guys, catch this. Because if you catch it, you start to like treat life like a video game. Good. And the boards are easy. Right? The boards are easy. You already beat the game because it's the same thing in every situation, right? These are the same rules. They apply every single time. It doesn't change. So now when you come to a new challenge, you're like, oh, I know what to do. I know what to look for, right? If I establish patience with this situation, okay, I'm going to grow. When I start to grow, I'm going to develop confidence. Then I have an understanding of how all this works. It's that simple. It really is that simple. But somewhere along the line, we lose sight of one of these things and it throws everything off. It's usually patience.
I was gonna say patience.
That's why it's first on the list. It's usually patience.
Patience.
Right? Like your process of DO is probably grueling, figuring out what college you wanted to go to, right? And so now, no patience. Mom, I don't want to sit down and talk to nobody from no organization about no scholarships. I'm done. I did what I had to do. I am done. I want to give back to my entrepreneurial endeavors. I'm done. I don't have time for this stuff, right? But there's something that happens when you practice patience. Develop confidence. Right? Just the patience to stop and talk to some more people might be the difference between $4,000 and $40,000 for this college. Right? What is your lack of patience keeping you from? You know, growth can mean a number of things, right? Growth is not just you as a person. Growth can be financial. There might be some financial information that you're keeping yourself from because you lack patience. Right? And if you don't grow financially, you ain't gonna have no financial confidence. You can't walk into the store confidently when you're there broke. You can't go to the dealership with confidence. You can't go meet the realtor with confidence. Because you ain't got no money. You can't buy no house. You ain't got no money. And you certainly aren't gonna understand the process. Right? Okay, let's move on. Anybody got any questions so far? Next thing, wisdom. Don't think you have to be 50, 60, 70, 80, 90 years old to have wisdom. See, once you have understanding about something, what can you do? Once you have understanding, what can you do with that information that you have?
Share it with others.
Huh.
Share the information.
Right. That's wisdom. That's wisdom. Why do you think I'm stressing JT if I have information? So he can grow, be more confident in himself, understand the process, and then take that wisdom and share it with Jairus. Share it with Miles. Share it with other people who come into the program. Right? Dion, one of the biggest things for you as an entrepreneur, okay? Once you learn to be patient with the process, you're gonna grow, right? Grow, become confident as an entrepreneur. You develop an understanding of how entrepreneurial things work, okay? Now you have wisdom, and you can start to teach classes on how to help other people become entrepreneurs. Or you can teach your employees how to be better performers. But it takes patience first. So people want to talk about, you know, the X's and O's of entrepreneurship. They don't want to talk about people skills. So you can have all this information and know how things work, but be a terrible people person, and now you have no team because nobody wants to work for you. You need patience and you grow, develop confidence, have understanding, and share that wisdom. Alright, so we're gonna move on to the next one. If anybody has questions at any time, just raise a hand, we'll get into it. Alright. Next one. Jairus needs his glasses. Direction. Direction. If you have patience, you grow. When you grow, you develop confidence. From that confidence, you gain an understanding. From that understanding, you have wisdom. Now you have direction. The reason why some of you guys are so stressed out is because you aren't patient enough to go through this process so that you can now fully understand where you're going. You guys might have goals, but you don't believe in it. That's why it feels like it's not working. Because you're not patient. You don't have the understanding. You don't have the wisdom. So you have zero direction. It seems like your goals, your dreams, your desires are on one side of the room and you're on the other. And there's a big gap in the middle and you're trying to figure out how do you build the bridge from where you are to where your goals are, how do you get there? That's tough. But you can't skip steps. Some of you guys are trying to get direction without the other steps. It don't work like that. Dior, you want to grow your business. Okay? You have to have all of those things before your company has direction. And it's a cycle. It keeps going. It doesn't stop. Each department is going to have bylaws and things that they go by. And you're going to have to train your people so that they have those skills and they can give to the people that are under them. Your business, in order for it to be successful, has to be successful from the mailroom up, from the boardroom down. It has to go both ways. All right?
Right. Purpose.
Next one. Teamwork. How many people like you are on your team?
That's a good one. That's a good one. That is a good one. Dead end street.
How do you guys think this is going to go down on a solo mission? Yeah. If your plans only involve you, you might as well crumble them up and throw them away. Because it's impossible. It's impossible. You don't have nobody else on your team that's getting up at the same time that you want to get up, that can motivate you to say, yo, D, not today, bro. You can't sleep in today. Come on, we got to go get it. And then vice versa. You gotta have somebody on the team that's equally as hungry as you are, if not hungrier. But see, sometimes we purposely recruit people that we know won't motivate us. Because we know we wanna chill.
Yeah.
Oh, look, man, I need somebody that's lazier than me so I can make myself feel good.
Oh my God.
So when I stand next to this joker, I feel great about life because, you know, you got a 3.6, 3.7. You ain't trying to chill with nobody with a 4.0. You got to be the smartest guy in the room. I'm not going to get a bunch of 4.0s. Make me feel bad like I got to do more work. Now I'm going to go get the guy with the 2.8 and be like, hey, man, better next time.
No, seriously.
That's what we do. We don't want to go be the small fish in the big ocean. We don't want to do that and rise to the occasion, right? People don't rise to the occasion. They sink to their level of preparation. So I want you guys to really think about your team. Dio, you're about to go into college right now, sweetie. I'm telling you, the most important thing you can possibly do is start to look for your teammates. You want to be a successful entrepreneur, you got to start thinking, what departments is your business going to need? Oh, I need photography. Who's in the photography department? I'm choosing that kid. Everybody else is laughing at that kid. He's a dork. He's a dweeb. He's this. Nope. That's my guy for photography. I need a graphic designer. I need a videographer. I need a finance person. This is what it is. College is nothing more than a huge, expensive networking party. If you look at it as anything else other than that, you're in trouble. That's all you want to be using school for, networking. And if you're not in school, then that's what you use the world for, networking. You want to network. Where do important people tend to hang out? People that have a little bit of money, who are successful, where do they hang out? Where do they go? What's a typical person do that's successful? Where do they go? Do they drink coffee?
Yeah.
Where do they drink coffee?
Starbucks.
Where do you need to be?
Starbucks.
There's a guy, I read an article about a guy one time. I forget his name. He wanted to sell charter jets. He knew that he needed to have a wealthier client base. So he found out about some convention that was going on with some of the world's wealthiest people, and he said, I gotta get into that convention and I'm gonna make my pitch. When he gets to the convention, it's invite only. He can't pay to even get a ticket. What he did was, he hung out at the cafe and he noticed that everybody that was going into the convention was coming to the cafe. And they were buying a specific item. They was buying muffins and coffee. So he wakes up, 4 something the next morning, he buys all the muffins. Sits outside the store with the money. If you let me give you my sales pitch, I'll give you a free muffin. How innovative are you guys for the dreams that you have? Where are you going to meet your dream halfway? What are you willing to do? How are you recruiting for your team? You trying to figure out why the dream ain't working? Look at your team. What's your team look like? You want to model, you want to do poetry, you want to do... How many other people that are involved in the industry? They don't have to do the same exact thing that you do, but can assist what you do. How many of those people are you engaged with on a regular basis? How many top 50 ball players in your graduating class do you know that you're friends with? You ain't even going to the camps to meet them. If I'm JT right now, who's the best ball player on the high school team? Whoever he is, we need to be cool. You need to be telling him to come work out here. Yo, man, this is how you can come work out. Because one of the biggest struggles that you have is the feeling of being uncomfortable when you go into a tryout. But if you start working out with two of the best guys on the team, what does that allow you to do in a tryout? Feel a lot more comfortable. Now, if you've been cooking the two best guys all summer long, yeah. When the tryouts come, they defer to you now. Now they're looking for you to pass you the ball because you've been cooking them all summer. You guys ain't playing the game right. Nah. You ain't setting yourselves up for success. You set yourselves up for failure. Then you get mad when it don't work out because you ain't being creative enough. You got smartphones, but you moved them. All right, next one. Resilience. Somebody look at resilience for me. Tattooed on my forearm. Hmm. Capacity to recover quickly. Why would you need that?
Because you're going to face adversity.
You're going to face adversity.
Yeah. You're knocked down, you get back up immediately.
Yeah,
you
can't stay down so long.
Read that again, Ray. The capacity.
The capacity to recover quickly from difficulty and toughness.
Mm. When you cool, you dress fly. You walk outside, and the curb is a little uneven, and you stumble. What do you do?
Check to see if it's
cover quick. Make it look cool. Hey, on beat, baby. I'm on beat. I'm out here. That's how you gotta handle situations in life. Recover quick. Some of you guys like to do what JT used to do at LA Fitness. You stumble and sell the fly. Oh my God, I'm so hurt. Somebody, everybody, look at me. Attention, please. Stop what you're doing. Somebody pick me. Life don't work like, ain't nobody coming to get you, man. Get up. Ain't nobody coming to get you. Get up, recover quickly. Give yourself 20 minutes, 30 minutes tops. Damn, I can't believe that messed up. All that preparation, all that planning, everything, and then it just, oh, it was a bust. Start the timer. In your mind, mentally or physically, literally, start the timer. When something goes wrong, put the timer, going, like let it go on your watch. 20 minutes. I got 20 minutes to beep about this thing. After that, solution base. Get you a complaining partner. Call somebody. Yo, man, I just need you for 20 minutes. I got a vent. I can get this off my chest. So from here to the grocery store, from here to the basketball court, from here to wherever your destination is, that's the time that you have to complain. And when you're in that phone call, it's time to get back to work. We don't do that. We got stuff festering. 24 hours, 48 hours, 72 hours. We just keep going until it becomes a way of life. So now you live out the problem. Resilience, recover quickly. In business, all right? I have a good friend of mine. It's amazing, right? So, situation happens, COVID happens. He's got a car company that he's running. I don't know if you guys see me promoted a lot. You know, on my Instagram, Posh Luxury Imports, right? It's the only luxury, black-owned luxury car dealership in the state of California. And it's in Beverly Hills. He also does rental cars as well, right? He opens his showroom right when COVID hits. He had to pivot. He's got to figure it out. Because you need people in the showroom in order to sell cars. He shifts his business to online. You call up, or you go online and you tell them exactly what car you want, they deliver it to your doorstep on a flatbed. Pivot. Recover quick. Resilience. Right now, the car industry is going through an issue, right? Where they're struggling to get inventory for cars. They can't get inventory because the chips are not being processed fast enough. They're not being made. They don't have the chips to go inside the car, so they can't do anything with the car. So I'm calling my boy trying to get my niece a car. He ain't hit me back. You know, and I'm like, hey man, what's up, man? You plug, bro. I'm not asking for it for free. He like, man, he ain't got no inventory. Right now, Honda Accord, $15,000 going for $26,000. That's $11,000 over the asking price. Because there's so few cars. He said every car got at least seven people on the wait list. So now stop worrying about me. And I, hey man, what you gonna do? He said, hey, there's a lot of people struggling right now. They in leases that they trying to get out of. We're buying their leases from them and selling the cars. Resilience. how fast are you going to recover? You got to pivot, have faith, and go the other direction. That's life. That's life. I don't want to see anybody in a situation where something happens and you like, woe is me. You ain't got time to make wounds, man. Bandage that bad boy up and keep going. It's that simple. All right? Next one. Strength. So after we've gone through all of these things, it's safe to say that you're going to be a strong individual. Some of you guys are a lot stronger than what you realize, but you play up on your weaknesses, so you never get to see what you're strong in. You're so worried about what you don't have, that you don't focus on what you do have. You might be worried about a couple dollars. Somebody like me had to grow up without a father. And you're worried about dollars. I give you every dime I had as a kid. I had a fall. Or a healthy relationship with my mom. I give you every dime I had to have two loving parents. I wouldn't even think about it. I get all my clothes from Walmart. I go through it to have two loving parents. You guys be worried about the wrong thing. You in an attic with no windows. It's real. Life can do you some blows. You got roaches up there? I did.
I dealt with the roaches.
You had the rats up there? You got. Okay, it's okay. It's better than what it was. Right? Now, knowing your circumstance, you should never be ashamed of it. Knowing your circumstance, do you look at anything like what you've been through? So as far as I'm concerned, it's whatever you show me. So if you go into Starbucks, put your business ideas, and you on your laptop with your smartphone wall working, and you come across somebody who's on their phone talking about business, you say, hey, you got youth on your side. You look the part. What do you think you're going to end up after that conversation? That's your strength. A lot of times you don't realize that our strength is our hardship. You know how much easier it's going to be for you to overcome certain things because it wasn't handed to you? Like you didn't just make the team. You know how lazy you would be if you made the team 2 years ago? Even like everybody else would be. You put them to work in, you're ready for the team. You had to get cut in order to establish work ethic. You'd have been a bum. You understand? Full of yourself, thinking you're the man. Trash. This version of you would have killed that kid. Head to head, but wouldn't even be close. But the adversity that you went through by not making the team, it forced you to change the things that you do. That changed your life. Getting cut was the best thing that ever happened to you. Because now you get to see what you made of. Now you get to see how strong you are. So now you can honestly say, I'm better than anybody else on the team. You couldn't say that before. You should say that now. And if you're not the best, you got the top three. I don't think you can be on the team today. All right, so clear understanding, man. Focus on your strengths. There's things that you're running from right now. You don't, listen, I know nobody intentionally turns the ball. You're not intentionally forgetting the ball or your sneakers or whatever else you forget. It's not intentional, right? But there are things that you can do to stop that from happening. It's on you. There are certain strengths that you have as an individual, but we can't ever get to those strengths. You're not allowing it to have its perfect work in your life. Sometimes you gotta take those blows. Get beat up enough, you're gonna learn how to fight. I'm telling you. If nothing else, you're gonna learn how not to get beat up. You get punched in the face a couple times, you're gonna learn to block. Then you're gonna learn to counter. That's what happens in life. But if you ain't never get knocked down before, and you keep going through life looking for things to soften the blow, when somebody finally does punch you in the face, you're gonna run home. I'm telling you, we see it all the time. We laugh at those guys. That hurts you? Look at some of the NBA players, man, when they get hurt. You should be like, man, come on, bro, I know that. It didn't even look that bad. You out for what? How long? Because their whole career, they're going to be. They're going to have to push them nothing. First sign of pain. I'm out. Are you with me? I remember I was coaching, right? And I was coaching this team, it was all one coaching. And we were going up against a team that was all another coaching. And the team that I was coaching had their parents and things, cheering for them. And everybody was excited, ready to go. And the ball went up. Game started. 2 minutes in, we down 15 points. Championship game. We down 15 points. Ain't nobody on their side cheering. We call a timeout. Our kid's gasping for that. We trying to come up with a game plan. Nobody's paying attention because everybody's looking to their parents for Gatorade. Mom comes over, there's one kid Gatorade. A red one? Who the blue one? Hate red. Look on the other side, coach is in the middle of the huddle. All the kids locked on him. They ain't even got water on their side. Right then and there, I knew one thing. We got to lose. And we ain't going. We ain't coming back. We ain't got what it takes. We too soft on this side. They ain't gonna let up, and we ain't prepared for this fight. We ain't got no strength. None. We complain about the color of the Gatorade. They ain't even got water on it. We done. There's no need for me to scream and yell. And they already quit.
They got hit about 15 times.
That was it.
Counting.
No counting. Because they ain't never been punched before. Undefeated. Won the island. Always win the island. Now we here against some people that ain't got nothing to lose. That's all we got. How you going to fare when you go up against a kid that ain't got nothing to lose? He ain't got no food in his fridge. You got new sneakers. He don't. You fresh. You smell good. He wish he could take a shower. What you gonna do with your fat kid? You ain't ready. Because he ain't got nothing to lose. He ain't got nothing to lose. You gonna throw your little punch? He gonna eat that because he didn't get punched a whole lot of your life. He gonna throw one back at you. But behind that punch is everything that he felt in his life, everything that he wanted. And you won't get every bit of it. And you ain't gonna be able to do nothing anytime. Because you're running from adversity. You ain't got patience. You ain't allow yourself to grow. So you ain't got no confidence to respond to that punch. You don't understand what just happened to him. You ain't got no wisdom to deal with it. When he hits you, you don't know where you're going now. Nobody can help you because everybody on your team is personally selected by you to make you feel comfortable. So nobody can even help you respond to this punch that you just received. They looking at you like you was the leader. You recruited us. So when you got punched, no need of two of us getting punched. I'm out. Go time. No resilience. No strength. All right. Two more. Courage. There we go. You got strength, you got courage. Courage is going to allow you to take that blow that life throws you. Come right back. Oh my God, that hurt. I just got punched dead on in my nose. My ears are ringing. My nose is bleeding. I'm scared to death. But let's go. That's how you got respond. Oh, it's on now. That's all you're doing. Oh, it's on now. It just got real. Okay. I know what to do here. I learn now. Oh, you drop that shoulder when you're about to come back. The world, the cycle is the same way. If you think about the problems that you've had throughout your life, it's the same thing. You're impatient about something. Alright, it gets thrown into your lap. You have no growth. You go through all these steps. There's no confidence. Alright, then you end up getting hit again. Because you're trying to take a shortcut. You're trying to skip some steps. You start complaining. You start looking for a way out. You start asking somebody to help you and make it easier for you. You gotta have courage. Gotta have that courage, but you can't skip no steps. If you don't do all these other things first, you're not gonna have no courage. You can't be courageous without strength. You can't have strength without resilience. And when it does get difficult, if you ain't got the right people around you, where's the resilience gonna come from? All these things play together, guys. All these things play together. Okay? Last one. Gratitude. How many of us are actually grateful for the things that we have to go through? I had to sell crack when I was 9 years old. I was forced. That's why I forced myself there. Hard time. Selling crack in friends' moms. Blue tea, causing beef between you and the group. Young boy know you something's more crack. That's his sleeping money. That's their food money. She taking welfare money. She buying crack. That's tough, man. I mean, I got beef for breakfast, lunch, and dinner, bro. I'm trying to tell y'all. Like, physical abuse was unreal. And I'm going to the stove, extension cords, looking back, so crazy. But I'm grateful. Because it made me what I am. If I don't go through those things, I'm probably not as loving as I am. I'm probably not as excited about life. I'm probably not doing this class right now. I probably don't have anything to give. I'm probably only concerned about me and what works in my life. So I'm grateful. I'm sure that I could have been this person some other way. That's not what happened. I became this person because of all of those things. That's how this happened. So I'm grateful. When's the last time you were grateful for your struggles? Because you understood what was on the other side of it. You keep complaining about the very thing that's going to make you great. Take this away. I don't know if this is. I thought you said you wanted to be great. I thought you wanted to be rich. Ain't no easy way to do this. I don't care what your skin complexion is, man. It ain't no easy way to do this. They ain't out here just giving out opportunities, man. You gotta work for it. You gotta earn it. You gotta have some chops and skin in the game. That's how this works. Dior wants to be an entrepreneur. She's gonna do it. She's gonna kill it. Ain't nobody gonna just throw $250 million out because she got a nice smile. You gotta go through some things. You gotta prove that you're worth this investment. I love her, but I'm not gonna just give her $250 million because she's Dior. So you gotta go through some things. But you guys are afraid to go through the very things that are gonna make you great. Because society tells us that it's supposed to be kick your feet up for that. It's easy. What if you got excited about adversity? What if you got excited about it? What if you just literally was like, you know what? Let me get some of that. Let me get some of this adversity over here. That's what y'all doing over here? That's how you got here? Tell me one wealthy person you know that didn't go through some adversity. Tell me one successful person, Andrew Johnson. Tell me one person that you know that didn't go through some adversity. I can't think of one.
Everybody has a story.
I mean, if that's at the core of all successful people, then I'm waking up in the morning like, whoa. Where's the university at, baby? Let's get some, because I'm trying to get this check. What I got to go through to get to that? All right, we're going to move on. It's high. Leadership definition. I love you. Love you. Adversity is directly connected to our propensity to withstand various obstacles, our ability to adapt and grow in the midst of life's turmoil. You can put that in your own words. That's just me. That's how I decide to define it. Propensity, inclination, or natural tendency to behave in a particular way. Okay. Adversity is directly connected to our ability to feel compassion and the likelihood that we'll show empathy to others. When you truly embrace adversity, you develop empathy for other people who are encountering an adverse situation. Great, I got an unfathomable amount of love for you because I just know your story. I can relate to it. I know the importance of having someone in your corner that say, bro, don't sleep on yourself. Believe in yourself, push forward, you can make it happen. You can tell certain people certain things about yourself and they'll hit you with it. You tell me, I'm gonna say, so, what you wanna do now? Because I've been there. I'm actually excited because I know what that means. You one of those guys. You one of those leaders. You one of those, like, you know, change the world type of guys. That's who you are. Oh, you got a message. You got a gift to give people. Oh, so what you upset about? Just your resume being built. Don't nobody want to hear anybody talk about how to handle life that ain't been through nothing.
That's true, man.
You got the silver spoon,
yeah.
Everything handed to you, and you about to get up here and tell me how I can handle adversity. So my man, you got to go get another speech. So just say, we've seen it. We've all seen it. We've all seen it in various situations. Whether you're working a 9-to-5 and you got a book and you're like, oh man, this dude's an idiot. Who he knew? Oh, somebody put you in this. You ain't earned this. That guy's never respected and he don't last long. You can tell he's a jerk. He's not, you know what I mean? Like, people that are jerks, and certain, you know that they didn't earn that position.
Yeah,
it was handed to him. Because when you earn that position, you move differently. You move with a certain level of grace. I watched your dad go through things with people that blows my mind. He's so calm in situations, it makes me upset. We're in Philly, and the dude behind the counter at the pizzeria said something slick. And the cops handled the situation so smooth. And I was mad. I was ready to jump over the counter. Because I'm like, this guy's so nice, man. Like, who are you talking to like that? Now, for me, I probably would have been cool too. But because it happened to him, I felt a certain type of way about it. Because he's so calm. But that tells me he's been wrong. He's been wrong. It's not his first rodeo. So he's not going to follow him. He's got patience.
Yeah.
He's allowed himself to grow. All the things he's talking about. There's some things in him. He's got it in him. But the guy who got no patience, he got an end. It didn't work. All right, come on this one. All right, question. Here we go. Where do we face the most adversity and why? Where do we face the most adversity and why? Any ideas real quick before I bring up my nice little chart that I made for y'all? Miss JT, any got this. Where do you face the most adversity in life? Oh, Jarrus about to say something. Woo! Let's go, baby.
New beginnings.
Okay. What you think, Jay?
I think it's the new beginnings, and you don't have the patience to get because you want to already be at the end.
Yeah.
Cool.
That's kind of well.
Let's jump into this right here. Nice little chart right here for you guys. So, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 types of adversity. Physical adversity, mental adversity, emotional adversity, social adversity, spiritual adversity, and financial adversity. Six different types of adversity. So physical adversity. I keep rolling my damn ankle. Physical adversity. I keep injuring my ankle. Every time I get to a certain place in my basketball career, I injure my ankle. Okay? Weight loss or gain. Physical adversity. Okay? Some of us struggle to put weight on. Some of us struggle to keep it off. I only gain weight in my midsection. Alright? It ain't a diet situation. It's a health situation that I need to address. Right? Physical adversity. Okay? Disability. We're starting to see a trend now in the basketball world where there's basketball players with no arm, no hand, whatever. We're starting to see that now. Right? Disability. Fatigue. Always tired. Always tired, man. Just wake up from a nap and feel like I need to go right back to sleep. There's a reason for that, but we need to look at that, right? Mental adversity. Some of us can't get past mistakes. Missed opportunities, okay? Troubled childhood. That's huge, right? For a long time, I was held captive by the fact that I didn't have a strong family setting. For a long time, that was my life. Even it came out of my music. I was listening to songs one day and I was like, man, I said the same thing over like 8 songs. I gotta let that stuff go, man. It's time to start rapping about something different. I don't want to be held captive. That's why the next project is called Last Time Losing. Right? That was my last time suffering loss. Mentally. Okay? Monkey mind. Mind all over the place. We can't stay focused on the things that we need to do because we are haunted by all these other things. Like we even get to the point where the physical adversity becomes mental adversity. Because we're stressing about the physical restrictions, right? Can't go to Morehouse this week or next week because I ain't ready, my ankle ain't ready. I don't want to roll. So what was now physical becomes mental. Can't go to the pool to take that shirt off. Okay, good. What was physical becomes mental. All right. The loss of loved ones. It's hard. A grandparent, aunt, uncle, sibling. It happens all the time. It's tough. All right. Emotional adversity. A lack of self-worth. You guys coming out of your teenage years and into young adulthood, it's very important that you understand what's worth. Society will have you believe something different. If your hair is curly as opposed to straight, depending on what your view is of beautiful, you can tell me. It's obvious we do need more, you know, positive images of young black people. If I wasn't from this country and I was from another country and I was of another race, I would think that black people just like to party, do drugs, have sex, and shoot each other. We just go by the images that we see. You know, right? So how does that affect a young impressionable mind that sees the world through media's view? Okay. How does it affect someone like JT, who is Asian? And then we see certain things like Jeremy Lin, what he went through, or we see where he might be counted out as soon as he walks into a workout or a tryout because he's expecting to be really good at math but not basketball. Whether we feel like it's a positive stereotype or not, it's still a stereotype. Right? And there's still a sense of adversity in his life. But he is really good at math, though. So are a lot of black students, right? So, something to think about, okay? Deep-rooted doubt. When we run into situations where we have like consistent, and I don't even want to call them failures, but consistent trials, it creates a lot of doubt. I'll use myself as an example. Because my family structure was so messed up, right? My mom almost lost her life giving birth. Therefore, when they filled out my birth certificate, I didn't fill out the right name. My name that I was given is Matthew Nathaniel Reeves. All right. The name that's on my birth certificate is Nathaniel Curzon Reeves. Why is that? Because they made a mistake in the hospital. And when my father's name is, my biological father's name, it says unknown. And they took his first and his last name and put it as my first and middle name. My mother's last name. Now, I never knew this. My mom changed it on my social security card. At school, it's Matthew Nathaniel Reeves. Now, I gotta go get my license. Give my social security card. So, I don't need an ID that says the correct name. This is not the name that we have at the university. I don't have a university. I gotta order it. When I order it, I'm like 20 something years old. And I find out my name is Nathaniel Curtin Reeves on my birth certificate. Keep in mind, this is a man I've never met. And I'm named after him. And I have no connection to this man. So I was 19 before I even seen him. And I never met him. Just a picture. Apparently, he died when I was 12 years old. He didn't live far, just right across the bridge in Brooklyn. So, now I'm going through this. Having to deal with these issues growing up, everything was difficult. Everything, going to college was difficult. Getting my license, my permit was difficult. Applying for jobs, difficult. Waking up in the morning and just having to deal with the doubt in my brain, was difficult. Being at college, about to finish, and then my major losing its accreditation, and they're telling me I had to do an additional year and a half, and they had to withdraw from college because I exhausted all my loans. Everything was different. I'm just telling y'all, I had none of the things that I'm telling you guys to practice. All of this comes from my life experience. This is what I had to figure out. And it took 20-something years and a lot of turmoil throughout my 30s because I had no training but life, all right? Anger and rage, I can tell you right now, when you finally first decide to fight back and you don't have all those other things figured out, you don't have gratitude. You have anger and you have rage. And you ready to take it out on whoever, whenever, at any time. Thank God I have some sort of spirituality about me, and I can pray about that anger and that rage. But on paper, I should have a couple of assaults on my brain. I'm just telling you. Right? This, again, I don't want to be super religious. I can only pull from what I know. Scripture in the Bible that says, be angry and sin not. It jumped out of the book to me. Like, whoa. Be angry and sin not. So it's okay to be upset, but don't allow it to control your life. Don't allow it to put you in a compromising situation. Right? My man, every time he says, you're already in pain, you're already in disease, make it worse. Get something out of it. Right? Next one. depression. Sometimes we can be fighting depression, we don't even know. I can't tell you the last time I cried. But I can tell you the last time I cried.
Yeah.
The last time I cried, I don't know why. I just was tired. I was tired.
All situations.
Everything. I was just sitting down, thinking about life, and how messed up it was, and how it wasn't fair, and how nobody was there, and how I didn't have any help, and how everything was a fight, and I was tired. You know what happened during that time? You get a little angry, you become self-destructive. You start to sabotage opportunities because you start to imagine things going wrong before they even get started. So you self-sabotage. There's opportunities and events that I could have attended that would have furthered my career as an artist that I said, I ain't gonna do the same thing every time. I ain't wasting my time. I already spent so much money trying to get on. Doing that shit right here. Can't fall from the curb, can you? Go too high, you're hurt. I ain't even go to the first floor. Stay right here in the lobby and chill. Safely. That's depression. Some of us might be bad with depression and not even know it. Because we tell ourselves that don't really matter to me. It does. It matters a great deal. But we're not honest about the fact that it matters. I don't care what people think. That's you. Care what people think. You want people to like you. You want people to love you. That's why we post things on Instagram for likes. We don't post for I don't care. Listen, likes matter so much. If the post don't get enough likes, you take it down. Archive it. And repost it to see if we get more.
That's crazy. That's crazy.
It matters.
That's crazy.
But if we get out in front of it and we admit that it matters, then we'll learn how to tackle these situations, these issues. Okay? All right, now we're going into a social person. Okay? Lack of quality friendships. People that just check for you. Right? Yo, man, what's good? You all right? You straight?
I don't get that one. I do that.
Yeah, you gotta have better friends. You gotta have better friends. See, D say he don't get that, but I used to check him all the time. He ain't never hit me back. We don't hit those friends back. We hit the comfortable friends back. There's a few females that would check for you like that. But you wasn't checking for them.
Oh, damn. That's crazy.
This is what we do, right?
Yeah.
For somebody like Dior, she should have a long list of people that she checks in with and checks for them. But if you stay locked away all the time, it's gonna be hard for you to have them people that check for you. And you won't feel it when you're in a good mood. You never feel it busy because you're busy. When you're not busy. When you're not busy, and you feel like nobody understands you. Them books can only do so much. That research can only do so much. That bright brain that you have can only do so much. Nothing beats a, hey girl, you all right? Hell no, I ain't I. I'm tripping over here. I need to get out this crib. He's got me crazy. I'm about to lose my mind.
Oh, he's literally saying this.
Can we go get something to eat so I can tell you about how I'm not okay?
Oh my God.
But y'all ain't tapped in.
Know
what we do instead? Instagram.
You feel like this like this.
Front for the gram, baby. Do it for the gram. Hi.
Yo, dude, you put mad hashtags for more likes too.
Poor people skills. Poor people skills, man. JT, don't look at me.
I was gonna say something though. Like, this is like how poor people act rich to stay poor and how rich people act poor to stay rich.
Okay. That is. That's it.
Poor people skills, socially awkward, afraid to speak up. Alright, moving on. Spiritual adversity, a lack of faith. We be talking all that good stuff until we get tested. It's all good. Right? We're the most encouraging people as long as things are working out. As long as everything is going the way that we feel it should go. You know, it's all cool. I can't use my phone to show y'all this right now. So, let me show y'all something. The other day, my mom didn't even text me, right? Like, she didn't text me, like, hello, hey, something, you know, she didn't send me a picture of my foot. Swollen, like it's about to pop. Reaction to steroids that she has to take. Diabetic, but no other information. At the same time that she's telling me that, I got somebody hitting me at like reckless hours about some clothing that didn't want to get made. Somebody else hitting me for something else that they haven't needed for. Somebody else hitting me about a problem that we have. Somebody else hitting me about something else that didn't make sense. And then my lady's checking me. Hey, can you go over here and leave for how much? Can you? Then I come in and do a workout. And I got all that on my brain. And I come in and I laugh and go, damn, something, how you doing good? Everything I act. Why am I able to do that? How do I function at that level?
High sense of faith.
I got faith. It's going to work out. My cousin called me and said, yo, I'm going to blah, blah, blah. Go, forget that. I'm not going to do with you. I don't be stressed by other people's problems, man. Man, listen, I need this for you, man. Can you do that? I can do it again, bro. Yo, man, I was calling you. You ain't answering your phone? Bro, just because my phone is in my pocket don't mean I'm not answering. I got things to do.
Feel that one.
Gotta also have faith in yourself. You gotta have faith in your plan, in your strategy for the day. You gotta have faith that if you put the phone down, you ain't gonna miss nothing. You just wanna gain something. A lot of times, we don't wanna quiet the noise long enough to see the plan through. We allow ourselves to be distracted by all this outside noise. All the time. In fact, we start looking for it. We lack so much faith that it's going to work. We want something to pull us away from what we're working on. So that when it don't work out, we can blame that other thing. And not ourselves. That's how it works. I would have did it, but my mom wouldn't stop stressing me about cleaning my room and doing all this other stuff. And you know, and guys, give me a chance. If y'all wasn't putting so much pressure on me, then maybe I'll be able to do X, Y, Z. Nah. They could have brought you breakfast in bed, you still wasn't going to do it. Because it ain't in you. When it's in you, you're going to get it done. You got to go?
Yeah.
All right, boom. No sense of community. So that goes back to what we talked about, quality friendships, right? We got no sense of community. What community do you tap into when you hit a brick wall? Where's your spiritual community? Where's your financial community? Right? Let's have a good time community. We gotta have different sets of friends then.
If we can't get all of these things from the set, from one set of friends, then we have to have different sets of friends. Right? We've all heard this thing. We've all heard this term. We all heard that term, right? Like you are the sum of your five closest friends. Right? So whoever you spend the majority of your time with, have a good one, baby. Whoever you spend the majority of your time with, you're gonna be the sum of those five people. So if you hang around four broke dudes, you're gonna be the fifth one. Psycho.
It's just common sense.
Like, right. You know what my mom used to tell me when I was younger? If you stay in the barbershop long enough, eventually you're gonna get a haircut.
Yep.
Right? Okay. Poor diet as it pertains to reading, watching, speaking. Yo, if, excuse me the expression, JT, but everybody else is cool. If you listen to kill a nigga, bust a nigga in the head, shoot a nigga, pump this girl, do this, hey, mind what the mouth do, that's all day long. That's all day long. I got one better for you. If you consume, look at that fatty, black clothes, Alexander McQueen's, fatty, Lambo, Mercedes-Benz, mansion, look at all that money you got right there. If that's what you consume all day, you're gonna be depressed, man. All you're gonna do is think about what you don't have. You're gonna think your life sucks and everybody else's life is better than yours. Because you got a poor diet. I tell young kids all the time, you gotta spend all this time on YouTube watching other people's mixtapes. You ain't even got time to make your own. So now you're watching everybody else live the dream that you had. That time that you spend watching them, you could be developing your own skill. You got people that literally love the idea of being an entrepreneur, but they will spend the majority of their day watching other entrepreneurs do the things that they say they want to do. Instead of going out and practicing being an entrepreneur. If I'm Dior, I'm sale pitching everywhere I go. I'm trying. I'm walking up at Starbucks and I'm asking for a 15% discount because I'm Dior.
Hello, guys. How you doing? I would like to get a 15% discount on my drink. This Frappuccino I just ordered? For what? The young business owner, you know, just trying to work out my sales pitch and see if it works. Might not work in the first two Starbucks, but it's all right. I'm gonna find one. And you're practicing your pitch for when you have to find funding. You're practicing your pitch for when you have to brainstorm ideas. You have to convince people to come and be a part of your team. How much are you practicing being an entrepreneur every day of your life? It has to go beyond looking at a screen. It has to go into physical practicality. You got to tap in. You have to get to that point. All right? Negative self-talk. Something we're all guilty of, including myself. When I was younger, my mom used to say things like, when it rains, it pours. If it ain't one thing, it's another. All the time. So I grew up with that mindset. You grew up with a complainer's mindset. And then I grew up in a poverty-stricken area. Everybody around me had it. And you know what happens? You start to accept it as, this is the way life is. And then I went to an HBCU, and people had money. And they weren't selling drugs. They weren't doing anything illegal. They had money. And I realized then that I had been lied to. Because I literally thought, that if you were black, that meant life had to be hard. Yo, I stopped watching a lot of stuff about like black hate crimes because it was messing me up. I was consuming so much of that content, you start walking around outside like you screw facing white people for no reason. I'm thinking, I'm not saying it's not gonna happen though. I'm saying the consumption of so much of that gets in the way of living your life. You are what you eat. What's in your diet? If that's what you're consuming on a regular basis, man, you're going to be that, along with the negative self-talk. That's what feeds that negative self-talk. All these things you feel like you've been deprived of, all right? Now, lastly, financial adversity. Poor mindset, right? A poor man's mindset. If you approach every situation from the perspective of poverty, you're never going to be able to get ahead of it. Think about it this way. Did you ever live in a project? You live in the house? Cool. So now that you live in the house, you never have to go back to the project. And when you have children, they'll never know what the project is. You've got to live in the house. Your kids will never know what the project is. There's just certain things that your kids won't have to worry about. They may grow up based on how you grew up, and they may never even have a life in school. Because from your experience, you'll know what type of school to put your kids in advance because of the problems that you may have encountered while you were in school and say, nah, I don't want to put my kids in school because I don't want them to go through what I want. So I'm going to put them in school like this. Or I'm going to send them boxing classes so in the event that he do get into a situation, he can take care of himself and get right with him. Mm-hmm. So it's cool. That's going to give him confidence and all the other things that he needs so that he can avoid that and he'll be straight. Right? Mm-hmm. So we got to make sure that we're not passing along this poor mindset. Now, don't think just because you live in a house that don't mean you have a poor mindset. Because you could live in a house and just get by. And you start resenting your situation. Instead of looking at what you have, you start looking at what you don't have, and that's a poor mindset. Right? Okay. Lacking financial literacy. We all want to make money, but we haven't learned anything about money. Money has rules. Money follows these rules. Success in these breadcrumbs. You can follow the trail and see where money is being made. People who are successful in sales, people who are in finance and in the tech world, that's where all the money's at. All the money goes there. That's where it's at. Money. Right? So if we're lacking financial literacy, we don't understand credit, we don't understand the banking system and how that works, and interest rates, things like that. If we don't understand how a dollar is devalued, we don't understand these things. If we don't understand simple things like stocks, real estate, cryptocurrency, where the money is, if we don't start taking the time to understand even the basics of these things, just the basics, how can you ever expect to make money? It's not going to come if you're working a 9-to-5, bro. I promise you, if you guys are working a 9-to-5 and you think you're going to make money, ooh-wee. It's designed to keep you there. Think about it. If I can pay you $30 an hour, I got to be making at least $90 an hour in your position. Because I'm a business, right? And as a business, I need to make money. I need to make money off of you. You are the product. It doesn't make sense for me to make $90 an hour and give you $85. That ain't good business. I'm going to make $90 and give you $30. I'm going to keep you around. And listen, you're making $90 an hour for my company. So even when I give you a $5 raise, I'm only giving you what you're making for me anyway. But here's the other thing you got to realize. No matter how hard you work for that hour, you can never increase your hourly rate. It's never going to change. I'm going to always give you 30. If you're on salary, if you come in at 6 a.m., we're supposed to be at 9 a.m., and I make you stay later, and we're supposed to get off at 5, I make you stay till 9. You don't get extra money for that. You're on salary. There's no overtime. It's a salary. I can work you as long and as hard as I want. But if you create your own wealth, you make it. You know what I'm saying? know what? This week I'm gonna sell 5 ounces.
Law of averages. I go out there, I do what I have to do in order to sell 5 ounces. You control your hourly rate. How much is that time worth to you? Okay? Lack of discipline. One of the biggest problems that I used to run into when I first started making money was I knew how to make the money, I knew how to keep the money, and I didn't know how to make the money work for me. So I could have $10,000 for a long time. Mm-hmm. It wasn't going to be more than $10,000. I didn't even realize that each dollar I earned was an employee. If you don't send your employees out to work, any money. Every dollar you earn is an employee. Make your money work for you. Once you start to make your money work for you, you no longer have to work for money. You don't trade time for money. Absolutely. How much can somebody really pay you for your time? Think about this. When you accept a job making $90,000 a year, you say that in exchange for all the powers that I'm given, I accept $90,000.
It's actually not good.
At all.
I mean, average spending.
Yeah. Lacking quality skill sets. Okay. Acquire skills, man. Acquire skills that people will pay you for. And then you can teach other people how to practice those skills. And you can put those people to work for you with those skills. And so you expand how much you can earn off of that skill set. So coding, programming, finance, what I'm doing right now, some corporations, some way to pay tens of thousands of dollars for me to come and teach somebody. Then their people do this stuff. You understand? Right. Like, so you guys are getting $50,000 worth of game free, damn it. You know what I mean? But it don't mean nothing if you don't activate it, right? So you gotta activate it. All right, let's move on.
Okay,
cool. Yeah, no, I'm about to wrap it up real quick. So, show me a person who takes control of their own adversity, and I'll show you someone who can be impossible. All right, I'm gonna show you guys this clip real quick. It's my guy right here.
Easy.
I'm talking about max it out. Listen to me, y'all. Here's my, I don't play basketball. If you watch my videos and you watch me, I will not walk out of life. I'm going to crawl out of life. When I die, I'm going to I promise you, when I die, I won't be there. I won't have no energy left. Every practice, I don't want no energy left. Why? Because those other girls you're playing, they're young. And they're going to burn out by the second half because they're young. And what you're going to do is you're going to be able to do it tonight. This is what I love about life. When you look at all the motivational speakers, when you're looking at them, I say, they're ahead of me, I can get them. Why? Because they ain't been homeless. I have an advantage when you're homeless and you got a transfer. I flew first class today, right? It was so funny. I flew first class, and I guess it's a small flight, so when they served our meal, it was like a real turkey sandwich. You can see other people looking like, I'm flying first class. That's wheat bread. I saw them too. I saw them looking like, that's wheat bread with cheese. It's not warm. It was like I'm talking about like a middle school lunch that your mama would send you with a little small bag of chips. I murdered it. I was like, whoa, turkey. It was so much turkey, it was a cold cut. I took most of the turkey out, Lee, and just kept that much in there. I'm like, it's too much turkey. They looking like, how dare them serve me this? This is first class. I was home, like, let's go. I didn't eat like this when I was homeless. I didn't know when my next meal would come. Some of you, your problem is you can't deal with adversity. You look at adversity as something negative when it's not. Adversity is the best thing that ever happened to you. Why? Because when adversity happens, most people gonna quit. Listen, we're going into the fourth quarter. I'm working harder now than I worked in January, than I worked in May. I'm about to put it on now. Why? Because most of the people who do what I do, they're about to get tired. My son is 23. Lee, I promise you. We had a layover, went to my mama's house. He slept the whole time. He woke up and said, Dad, I don't know how you do it. I went and worked out, did the hit boy, walked with my mom for 3 or 4 miles with my niece, talked to my mom, got on the plane, got off. Boom, did a presentation. They was like fire pit. They was like E. best presentation you did all this year. I can't wait till the fourth quarter. I can't wait till the second half, because that's when talent goes away. All your talent gone with 5 minutes left. Your legs about to give out. So who wins? Only the person that can go through adversity, because that's when you start winning. So that's why you need to practice till you burn out. So when you get on the court, you'll never burn out. And they're going to burn out. They're going to burn out. I'm telling you. If you see it, it's like the game goes up and down and up and down. And the last four, y'all got to go watch Michael Jordan when y'all get a chance. He would always take a break at about maybe 10 minutes. He'd come back with 6 minutes left in the game, and he'd Mike would come in those last 5-6 minutes, he would kill you. He would kill you because he had so much energy and so much tenacity and so much strength. And listen to me, I noticed the Michael Jordan, and I'm old, so I don't believe in the Michael Jordan-LeBron comparison. Let me tell you why I don't believe in it. It has nothing to do with offense, because the way Mike played offense, he shut you down on defense. That's the difference. Mike didn't play one way. Mike wanted it so bad that he would put up 30 and he would stop his guy from scoring zero. That's the difference. He played both ways. How do you play both ways? When you're not playing talent no more. You're not playing with talent. At that point, you done dug deep within. Okay, I wasn't even supposed to say this, right? But I got to be honest. I'm going to give y'all one more. I shouldn't say this until I come back halfway through the season. Do you understand the reason why I beat most humans at what I do? Is because the last 10% is the hardest percent. The hardest percent, ladies. Last 5 minutes of game, says that's hard. Let me tell you what I mean by that. While the first 10% is difficult to get started, once you get started, it's something that's called momentum. The challenge with the last 10% of what you do, which makes it hard, is because it's the last and you can spend all your energy. That's why the last 10% is the hardest. And you know what I focus on? I focus on the last 10%. And you know what everybody else focus on? They focus on that 90%. So I need y'all to do me a favor. I'm going to need y'all to go and coach and say, Coach, you're not being hard enough, Coach. We need a little bit more mercy. We need a little bit more mercy, Coach. Coach, you're being soft in practice. I know we girls and you think we can't take it, Coach. I know what it is, Coach. We need you to bring it on, Coach. We need a little bit more adversity. Why? How many women in the room love diamonds? Let me see your hand. You love diamonds. Good. Good. And people spend a lot of money for them, right? Listen to me very closely. If you want to be a diamond, ladies, I'm not really into them like that. If you want to be a diamond, the first thing they do is put it on the most excruciating heat that you can put it on. It goes with heat first. Immense heat. After the heat. Now, I thought that was enough. You take the coal, you put it on the heat, and when all that stuff come off, whatever's left is the stone. That's not a diamond, though. It's just the stone. So when you go on the heat, and you feel like Coach can put you under some heat, that's just the, look, sweetheart, that's just the beginning. Heat is just the beginning of the process. So after the heat, when they want to form it, then they put it under pressure to form it. And then after that, it still ain't a diamond. They have to do what to it? You got to cut it. So the diamond that you see, there's no two diamonds alike, because when they cut it, each stone reacts different to it. I'm trying to tell you, you want to be a diamond, but you don't want to get cut. You want to be a diamond. You want to win a national title. You want to be a diamond, but you don't want to go through no pressure. You want to be a diamond, but you don't want to go through no heat. And I'm telling you, the best thing that ever happened in my life was homelessness. Why? Because when I took that PhD and that professor, oh man, my mom got so mad. That professor told me, Coach, you don't write well enough. You're not a critical thinker. You don't think well enough to be able to get past this dissertation. I knew exactly what she meant. She meant I had an IQ. But I had to explain to her, boo, IQ ain't the only way you succeed in life. I got that GQ. I got that GQ. And I ain't talking about being fine. I got that GQ. I got that grit. And so you know what I did when she told me that? I went to the library, y'all, and I read over 40 different dissertations until I found the one that looked like something I could write. I went in the library and was like, yep, she right, I ain't got the IQ, but they do have dissertations for free in the library. So we about to go to the library, spend a month here, and I found one like, I could do that. And I went home and I stripped it from top to bottom. I kept reading and reading and reading, and I saw what it was, and I said, I got it. And it took me 4 weeks Some people can do it in 24 hours, turn the paper in it, 4 weeks and 6 weeks, and I would turn it in early. She would give it back with red, and I'd give it back, and she'd give it back with purple, and I'd give it to her, and she'd give it back with orange. And I told her, you will not break me. You must understand something. This is a class. I was homeless. Homelessness didn't break me. You think a course go, you think a pedagogy 10-12 is going to break me? I was even on a trash can. I will defeat this. And some of you, your problem is that every single time you come up against heat, you run. You will never be a diamond like that. You will never be a diamond. Every time there's pressure, you want to break. Emotional, get emotional if you must. Cry if you must. Get it out. But get your butt back up after you finish crying and put a time limit on the grind. You say, Coach, I need 30 minutes. Don't take it. But when you come back after that 31 minute, you better grind. Because if you don't, you will be stuck at that adversity for the rest of your life.
All right, we're going to wrap this up real quick.
Okay.
Why we should create our own adversity. Are we going to run in with this control adversity? Putting ourselves in control with adverse situations allows us to practice overcoming at our own pace and on our own terms. We can take control of any adverse situation by simply being mindful of how we respond. When we create our own pressure, life's pressure becomes child's play. Start your day off with routine challenges. Prepping the mind for obstacles at the start of the day builds mental muscle. You guys can feel free to take a picture of this rather than have to write these things down. Strategically placing obstacles in your way serves as a training ground for the real fight. These obstacles don't have to all be strenuous, but they should be challenging. Some of the most simple tasks can create the biggest challenges. The simple task could be, instead of waking up at 7 o'clock, waking up at 6:45 or 6:30. That's a simple task. But it's a huge adjustment. It has huge implications.
Yes.
Right? It's not about doing the biggest thing. A lot of times, it's a bunch of small things that add up to a big result. Get comfortable with the idea of being uncomfortable. Go through life with your medicine ball. Alright, what do I mean by that? Going through life with your medicine ball. To run a race in and of itself is difficult. Right? Just to run a race. Just to run. Just to go around this block and run this, you know, or run this block 4 times. Okay? It's difficult. Maybe the first lap is cool. Second lap, you're like, I got this. Third lap becomes tough because you know you got one more lap, right? Now that last lap, I got this in me right here. But I'm gonna keep going a little quick. Now imagine doing that whole process with a medicine ball over here. For nothing more than to build toughness. For nothing more than to build that challenge. For nothing more than to add some adversity to what you normally do. So that you're prepared. How difficult would it be for you to make your environment something that you actually love? The environment that you live in. So why do you respond to the environment like it's like him? Run your race with a medicine ball. Beat life or beat adversity to the punch. I'm telling you, if you're running through it, put a medicine ball. When life comes and says it's time to run, you're like, what? Run. You know what I've been running with? If life typically is asking you to run 2 miles, but you train running 10 miles every day with a medicine ball, when life shows up and says 2 miles, you're like, I'll do this backwards on my eyes, but I'm not training. You know what's coming because you know what you want. So you can look around certain things and say, I'm like, JT, you know what's coming. You've been through 3 tryouts.
Have any of them been different? They all been the same.
Yeah.
Right? You pretty much get asked to do the same thing. So what if you just tripled what's expected of you in trials? Like if you just tripled that in your own work, the trials will come and go. I read somewhere one time, I don't know if this is true or not, but I read somewhere one time that Mike Tyson used to find out what his opponents were doing, like early in his career. He would find out like how many jump jacks they were doing, how many push-ups they were doing, how many miles they were running, and he would double or triple. So when he stands in the weigh-in, he ain't shaking because he knows more than three times as hard as you be right where you stand.
You can't lose.
You either win or you win. Some people like to say failure is not an option. But then you're recognizing that failure exists. So let's eliminate failure altogether and say you need to win or not. The only option is win. Someone told me a long time ago, he said, you know why rain dance with the Native American? Anybody know why?
Because they dance to it, rain.
They dance to regardless.
Say it again, what you said?
Why did rain dancing work for the Native American?
They dance to it, rain.
It took 6 minutes or 6 months. There was one dance stuck raining. Some of us don't want to dance that long. You don't want to dance until it rains. We put a time frame on. If it don't rain in 6 days, I'm stopping. I ain't dancing no more. Because it's ridiculous. You don't want it.
That's patient.
Yep. Okay. I appreciate you guys' patience.